So remember generative versus discriminative? So generative, I build a model of each class and then I compare it against all of them. Discriminative, I build a model of the boundary between the classes. So we've talked a bunch about building some discriminative one. Let's talk again about building generative. How might you build a reasonable generative model of each class of action? Okay. Well, remember, one of the reasons we might want generative models is we might not have a whole lot of examples. So a simple thing you might do is you've got a hue moment feature space, and we've got seven things applied to two images, so we get 14 numbers. So you could use some sort of Gaussian, or maybe it's a Gaussian with diagonal covariance so that you don't have to worry about having too many points. Or you might use a small number, mixture of Gaussians, but the idea is you would build a model, a Gaussian model for each of those classes. And then what you'll do is you compare the likelihoods. Remember, the likelihood was probability of the data given the model, right? So I build all the models, and then when the new data comes in, I evaluate the probability of the data. Then if I have a prior, then what I'm going to do is I'm going to use Bayes' rule. That's what it says here. That basically says I take my likelihood, I multiply that by the prior of my model, and that's proportional to my total posterior. If I don't have a prior, I might just select whichever one has the highest likelihood. And by the way, if I don't have enough data to even build some reasonable model of the densities, I might just use something like nearest neighbor. So the nice thing that we have is that most the motion energy images, motion history images, they're sort of little global descriptors. And the way you do this is you're going to collect these statistics on these global descriptors in order to do the recognition. One of the things that might be a little less obvious is you can't actually recognize the action till it's done, right? So I have this description that goes back in time. So if I'm watching a person sit down, when they're done sitting down, I now have that chunk of data that represents them sitting down. Most activity recognition these days, there's not a lot of focus on doing online recognition that as you're watching something happen. The idea is that they have the whole sequence to begin with. But if you actually are worried about recognizing it as it happened, this idea that I can't recognize something till it's totally done can be somewhat concerning, and you have to think about how you might deal with that.